There are three words that have been my bane. Three little simple words that often end up being my curse. They get me to do silly things, they cause me to act quite a fool at times, and they make me often aspire to greater heroics than I can actually muster, than me and myself can muster. And I wanted to share with you the three little words that will bend my will, the three little words that will get to me. Please, Uncle Scotty. Please, Uncle Scotty has caused me to do ridiculous things for my nieces and nephews. It's caused me to act in ways that are not, well, may still be in accordance with my age, but are starting to get a little bit more difficult, and it caused me to do things that almost would be considered dangerous. And this last year, I have a specific example. We were at the Dells with our family. We went to the Wisconsin Dells during the winter to one of the indoor water parks, and Kaylee and Calvin wanted to have some fun. Now, Kaylee was 10 at the time, and Calvin was about 8 years old. And they decided that it would be appropriate to use me to do their bidding. And they were like, "Uncle Scotty, we would like to go into the wave pool." Now, if you don't know what the wave pool is, it's the little big pool-like thing. I guess that's easy to understand. But it's supposed to imitate like a big storm. Like you go in it and the waves reach about 3 feet, 4 feet high. And it's supposed to imitate a storm and the water's all stirred up. And I think it's just to injure people. I'm pretty sure that's the only reason they have wave pools. It's so that people get injured. Well, Kaylee and Calvin are like, "Uncle Scotty, will you take us as deep as we can go?" Now, Uncle Scotty thinks to himself, this is going to be difficult. I am going to be tired, possibly get hurt, and could see us all flipping over. And then they look at me, and they're like, "Please, Uncle Scotty." I'm like, "No!" Those words, "Okay, we'll do this." So it is now my job to take not only my tube, but their tube with both of them in it, all the way to the deepest point in the water. So I not only have to get through all of the crazed spring break college kids, get past them, get past the other adults with their children, but I have to get to the deepest point. It's not easy. It's not easy to do alone, let alone with kids. And I had three main tasks at hand. First off, I had to protect my niece and nephew. I had to make sure they were safe. I couldn't get all the way to the deep end, have them flip over, and all of a sudden be blamed for them getting injured, because that would not have been a pretty sight. I had to fight the current. There was strong waves hitting my tube, and I had to press on. And also, I had to stay deep or go deeper. Now, the problem with the wave pool is they're pushing you away from the deepest point. They don't want you there. They want you to be pushed away. So not only did I have to hold on to Kaylee and Calvin's tube, I had to keep swimming and keep kicking and keep us deep. And that day is burned into my memory and also into my thighs because of all of the swimming and kicking that we did. But there was one important thing that happened on that day. We stood against those waves. We stood against those waves. And through the encouragement of my niece and nephews, and through just the sheer willpower that I put forth, we were able to encounter the waves that were hitting against us and stand fast. This text is going to deal with that situation. Not in that specific way. We're going to get there through some other texts. But this text deals with the idea that there are going to be people like myself at that time. There will be people who are mature, who can stand against those waves, and there are also going to be those people that are young, that don't have the specific strength. If you have left Kaylee and Calvin at that point, if I had taken them out there and said, "Okay, peace out, Uncle Scotty's going to drift inshore now, I got you to where I need to go," a multitude of things could have happened to Kaylee and Calvin. They could have flipped. They could have just wandered a little bit. Or they could have had some fools knock into them and cause a sort of ruckus. But because of the union that we had at that time, Kaylee and Calvin were safe and they were able to stay strong. Turn with me to Hebrews 5. And we're going to begin with our text. And we're going to look at, Dave's handing out Bibles, excuse me. If you do not have a Bible, he will bring one to you. And we will begin to see that union begin in this text. We're going to be studying verses 11 through 14. And for now, we are going to read verses 11 through 12. Hebrews 5, 11 through 12. About this, we have much to say, and it is hard to explain, since you have become dull of hearing. For though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you again the basic principles of the oracles of God. You need milk, not solid food. We'll continue. For everyone who lives on milk is unskilled in the word of righteousness, since he is a child. But solid food is for the mature, for those who have their powers of discernment trained by constant practice to distinguish good from evil. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, you are training your children. You are training us, and you are building us, and you are maturing us. And there is so much for us to take in. There's milk, and there is delicious solid food. And Lord, we ask right now that we would know our state, that we would be understanding of the position that we are in terms of our maturation. So that if we are still a child, that we would take in the wonderful milk that you've provided to train us up and to make us strong. And if we are mature, if we are discerning and trained in the word of righteousness, if we've grown through milk, Lord, we pray that we would take the solid food that you have given us and that we would be further strengthened and further disciplined and further trained up in what you provide. Lord, mature us. Mature us. Let us not continue in wayward activities, but rather let us see and understand our state, and let us grow in accordance with your desire. It is in your name we pray. Amen. We begin again in Hebrews 5, 12 through 13 with this need. Oh, excuse me. In Hebrews 5, 11 through 12. With this dullness in hearing that the author is seeing in the Hebrews. About this we have much to say, and it is hard to explain, since you have become dull of hearing. Dull of hearing. What does dull of hearing mean? I look at this text, and I think of the machinist curse that my father and I possess, and I believe my brother has it in part two. We have a curse upon our bodies that I refer to as the machinist curse. And what this means is that after having listened to machines whirring and buzzing for a number of years, the level of white noise that we hear is far more increased than the general population. What this means is if I'm in a group of about five people and there's more than two conversations going on, it's just one big jumble. It's not that bad at this point. I can still differentiate a lot, but I expect when I get much older, it's going to start to be more of a mess. So if I'm at a party, and it seems like I'm just nodding along, it's often because I can't understand a word that's coming out of your mouth. And I don't want to look a fool at 25. And so what is happening in this text is these people are dull of hearing. Though they're hearing something, they don't necessarily hear what they were intended to hear. About this, we have much to say, and it is hard to explain because you have become dull of hearing. The writer, the author, wants to explain the high priestly nature of Christ and how Christ is in accordance with the Melchizedek priesthood. And he has to stop, and he has to take a break because he understands that all of his audience is not going to receive this teaching. Because though he understands that they should be at the point of receiving this teaching as converted Jews, he knows that a lot of them are not going to be there. And part of the reason is a lot of them are just passive. They're just passive. We sang a bunch of Christmas songs this morning, wonderful Christmas songs that detail and describe great and glorious truths about the incarnate Son of God and the glory that we have in Christmas. And I don't know about you, but before I was 22 years old, Christmas carols didn't mean a whole lot to me. You see, from 15 to 17 years of age, I was a caroler at Case High School. I was a Christmas caroler. And for the month of December, we would do anywhere from 40 to 75 shows around the greater Racine area and even up in Milwaukee. We would get dressed up in specific caroling garb, which looked very classy. I don't know if you've seen me in an ascot, but I look pretty nice. We're dressed up in specific garb. We would have top hats on, which are delightful. And we would go and carol. And I remember singing Hark the Herald Angels Sings and having no idea what it was talking about. Just having it wash over me again and again. Because though I heard it, though it proceeded out of my mouth, it made no connection with my heart. And there's this dullness in hearing that we have around Christmas that fails to receive the glory and the treasure and the splendor that this holiday truly means. We're passive. We're passive hearers. Rather, what we need to be is purposeful hearers. Purposeful. You can no longer just claim, you know, I heard that. You know, I was sitting there at the party, and I clearly heard what that person was saying to me and the compliment they gave to our friend, and I was like, yeah. Don't be passive. Be purposeful. If you don't hear something, if you don't receive something clearly, seek it out. Seek it out. If you're reading the Word of God and a text washes over you, and you say, oh, I feel like I just skipped that. Don't say, that's all right. Return to it. Bask in it again. If the Christmas carols you've heard year after year after year mean nothing, and the story of Christ coming in the form of a child is just simply another story. Look again. Look again. Because there is treasure that can deceive. Why are they dull in hearing? About this we have much to say, and it's hard to explain since you have become dull of hearing. Why does the author note this? Verse 12. For though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you again the basic principles of the oracles of God. You need milk, not solid food. Why is the author stating not only that they're dull of hearing, but saying they had a specific need? It's because they showed initial enthusiasm. Initial enthusiasm. There was an initial response to the Word of God. They heard what was being proclaimed amongst their tribes, and they said, this is glorious. The Messiah has come. They received that truth, yet what they lacked was enduring discernment. They lacked enduring discernment. They had an initial response to the Word of God. They heard it. But there was no growth in understanding. And there was no reception of implications. The text actually carries on. Because they ought to have been teachers at that point. By the progression of time, they should have been teachers. But they needed those simplistic principles. Yet again, and we're just going to skip a little bit ahead in the text where it talks about the solid food. But solid food is for the mature, for those who have their powers of discernment trained by constant practice to distinguish good from evil. They had heard it. They had received the message. They had the time to be trained up accordingly. But yet at their standing, at that point in their walk, there was no discernment. There was no trained up understanding. They would hear the truth and say, oh, that's so glorious. But they wouldn't take it to the next step. We're not going to go to this text, but I was thinking of a text that this level of complexity could be seen in. And I thought of 1 Corinthians 6:20. You don't have to go there. And 1 Corinthians 6:20 says, you were bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body. And I can remember seeing that text. You were bought with a price. You were bought with a price. And thinking to myself how Jesus Christ died and paid the penalty for my sins. And what a glorious truth that was. And how wonderful I felt at seeing and receiving that truth. But so often in my walk, I wouldn't think through what the next part was talking about. I wouldn't think to myself, you were bought with a price. Now I need to glorify God in my body. I never thought to myself, what is the application there? What is the application that God is expecting me, that the author of the Corinthians, of 1 Corinthians, Paul, is expecting from his ears? I was just reveling the fact that I was bought with a price. I never took the time to understand what it meant to glorify God in my body. And so what we have is a group of Hebrews understanding these wonderful truths, hearing these wonderful truths, but never picking through and seeking out the application and then understanding what the instruction they would have to carry forward would be. But the time had passed. The time had passed and they should have matured. They should have been there. But they weren't. And so our author deals with them accordingly. So we read in 12 through 13, their need of milk. For though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you again the basic principles of the oracles of God. This means the undergirding facts, the basic truths. These are the starting points, the building blocks, the basic principles of the oracles of God. You need milk, not solid food. For everyone who lives on milk is unskilled in the word of righteousness, since he is a child. These were Christians that suffered from arrested development. These were unnaturally developed Christians, not matured, haven't grown up. They were stuck in a basic state of growth. Now, I don't want you to think of this it's a 32-year-old adult male living in his mother's basement, playing video games and not getting a job kind of way. Not that sort of arrested development. I'm talking about a 10-year-old infant. You have a 10-year-old infant on your hands. Your child is 10 years old, and they're still a baby. That's not how things are supposed to be. It's unnatural. It's unnatural for this 10-year-old to still be an infant. They should have been growing. There should have been a natural progression that is occurring. And yet, here they are, still an infant. And the truth is, they can't handle solid food. They can't handle it because they're unskilled in the word of righteousness, because they don't understand the basic elementary doctrines, what one would call the ABCs of the Christian faith. They could not receive solid food. Let's think of that. This is interesting. Let's think of having an infant. Joshua isn't here right now, so we can't use Joshua as an example. But think of having just a baby sitting in a high chair. Not even in a high chair. A baby that you would usually give a bottle of milk or formula, or you would see nursing. Now imagine having that baby in one of those sweet relaxing chairs that bounce a little bit. I can't remember what they're called, but Kaylee used to love them. It was great, so Uncle Scotty didn't have to hold her all the time. But you just have the child sitting in that, and bring to them a large meal. Let's say something that Uncle Scotty would like. Some prime rib, maybe some garlic mashed potatoes, and then the piece de resistance, a roll of bread. Oh. And butter. What would this infant do? I see three things that this child would do in sight of the wonderful medium rare prime rib that would be before it. The child would either just ignore it. I don't know what that is. What does that have to do with me? It's just going to be in it's going to be off in its own infantile state of mind. They don't want it. They have no desire for it. So they're just going to ignore it. All they can think about his milk. Or if they did choose to interact with it, they would probably choke on it. You give an infant an undercooked piece of prime rib that for Uncle Scotty is delicious, they would not be able to take it in. They would not have the teeth. They would not have the understanding of how big of bites they could handle. They wouldn't even know how to cut it. They'd probably just pick it up whole-handedly. How cool would that be to have a steak the size of your body to hold on to? I'm getting distracted. They would not be able to take in the piece of meat that was before them. They'd choke on it. Or number three, they would fail to digest it. Now, this is known as the messy choice, but they would not be able to, if they even got the food into their stomach, at that point in their development, they would not be able to digest the food they had taken in. They're not used to steak and garlic mashed potatoes. Garlic mashed potatoes and a baby. No, thank you. I don't want to deal with that diaper. That would be disgusting, or it would go the other way, and it would possibly be all over you in addition. A young infant child has not obtained the experience nor the skill to process that kind of food. They can't do it. There's no way for them to do it. And the same is true for a dulled infant Christian. They need time. They need time. They need time to learn to intake milk and digest it. They need to work through those basic principles, those founding doctrines, so they can work their way up to meat. They need to work their way there. They can't just be expected, here, eat this and grow. No, they need the foundations. They need the building blocks. The author understood that I can't just tell a new Christian about the order of Melchizedek and expect them to understand. I can't tell a new Christian about Abraham and expect them to understand. They need those foundational principles that came through the Old Testament scriptures to build them up. And the author's expectation in the book of Hebrews is that you are converted Judeo-Christians. You were steeped in the Word of God, in the Old Testament. And I'm coming to you to teach you. And you don't even know the connecting points? You have no understanding of the basic principles of what it means to be a Christian. And how can I teach you further? Spend some time in the milk and you will get there. So how does one progress from milk to solid food? How does one get there? If we have to start with milk, if there is an understanding that if you haven't experienced milk, you're not going to get to solid food, how does one progress there? How does one get there? Let's turn with me to Romans 12. We're going to look at two ways that we progress. We can never, ever expect a new infant baby Christians to be able to seek out and just chew on meat. They have to start with milk. They have to start there. And if they don't, the upcoming portions of Hebrews 5 will explain what will happen to them. Romans 12, 1 through 2. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. What was the expectation of sacrifice for Christians? All of ourselves. All of ourselves. Christ gave all of himself. We give all of ourselves. All that we have is for Christ. Verse 2, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. How does one progress? First off, we have to understand that milk transitions you to solid food. Transformation in the Christian sense comes through the renewal of our mind, which comes through intake. 12:2, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind. How does the renewal of your mind happen? through the working of the scriptures upon our hearts, through the taking in of the word of God, through preaching and teaching and discipleship and our own personal study, and allowing that to have transformative power, so that by testing, you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. So we need that milk. We need that time. We need that transformation. It's not all of a sudden, I can start eating meat now. No, there's a buildup. For a child to go from infancy to solid food requires carrots and not celery. I can't think of, like, squash and sweet potatoes. There we go. Uncle Scotty remembered them. There is a transition that slowly occurs to get us to that solid food. And we need that transformation. We need that sequence. Turn with me to Ephesians 4 for our next text, 11 through 12. So we need to understand that there's a transforming timeline. There is a process that's going to be occurring. For 11 through 12, we'll be reading more in Ephesians 4, so don't keep your finger there after we read this text. And he gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the shepherds, and teachers. Here it's speaking of leadership gifts that is spread among the church. To equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ. We're going to continue into 13. Until we all attain to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to mature manhood, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. What's the second means of progressing us? Understand how God has so composed the church. What we have as a body is not some random chance. It's not random that we have leadership structure. It's not random that God has so appointed gifts for the composition of body. It's not random that God has put in place certain leaders and certain people within the church who are skilled at discipleship and skilled at teaching. God has so ordained and composed the body that we would progress to maturity. That we would progress to maturity. This is not a baby teaching itself to love steak. This is not an infant saying, I'm done with milk. I think it's time for me to have solid food. No, this is a family. This is a family slowly taking an infant child, starting it at nursing and progressing it further and further along its developmental path until it is mature, until it can receive the fullness of food. And that is so utterly dependent, according to Ephesians 4, upon the whole frame of the body, and specifically the order of the leadership to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for the building up of the body of Christ until we all attain to the unity of faith. The goal for the church is not for infantile child Christians. It's for mature. Christ's desire for us is for us to be matured and for us to be growing. Keep your finger there. Turn back to Hebrews 5. We read in verse 14, but solid food is for the mature, for those who have their powers of discernment trained by constant practice to distinguish good from evil. So a child can't receive solid food. An infant cannot receive the child food because they're not there yet. They're not prepared. But put that prime rib, put that garlic mashed potatoes, put that roll in front of an adult, a matured person, and what do? They dig in. They dig in. They run to it. They gobble it up because it's delicious. They have practice. They have put their time in. They have built up a habit. Solid food is delightful. It's delightful. Solid food is great, but the immature can't handle it because they will choke. They will ignore it, or they will fail to take it in. They first must be prepared, but when prepared, they are strong. Turn back with me to Ephesians 4, 11 through 16. We just read that. And he gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the shepherds, and teachers to equip the saints for the work of the ministry, for building up the body of Christ, until we all attain to the unity of faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to mature manhood, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. So here we see the progression, how God is working through his church to mature people. Why is that happening? Verse 14. So that we may no longer be children, tossed to and fro by the waves and carried about by every wind of doctrine, by human cunning, by craftiness and deceitful schemes. Rather, speaking the truth in love, we are to grow up in every way into him who is the head, into Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and held together by every joint with which it is equipped, when each part is properly working, makes the body grow so that it builds itself up into love. Looking earlier, so that we may no longer be children. So that we may no longer be children. Tossed to and fro by the waves and carried about by every wind of doctrine, by human cunning, by craftiness and deceitful schemes. Why is our maturity necessary? Why is God maturing us? Because a child cannot handle the waves. A child is tossed to and fro. If Kaylee and Calvin had sought to take themselves into the depths of the whirlpool, they would have been knocked around. They would have been capsized, as it were. They would have possibly, worst case scenario, have drowned. The necessity of maturity in the midst of the Christian is because if there is not maturity, deceitful schemes have their way of deceiving us. Because we do not fully understand all that is being taught. There is a necessity of warning because many wolves will take hard passages and twist them before our eyes. If a person is not steeped in the milk of the faith, in the word of righteousness, they will not understand the deeper truths. So someone with cunning speech or persuasive words will come forward and will twist the word of God before our very eyes and will say, that passage doesn't mean that. It means this. And a child will say, oh, what a fool I was. You are so much more learned in the truth that I am than I am. Of course you have it figured out. Wolves will deceive. And as the author is looking at the Hebrews, he is saying, you should be teachers at this point. You should be teachers at this point. And the Judeo-Christian converts, the Hebrews that are receiving this letter, they would be drawn away from the glory that they should have been receiving. They would see, they would have received the original truth, and these deceivers are coming in. They should have been teaching the truth, but these deceivers are coming in and taking them away from what Christ would proclaim in their midst. Go with me to Galatians 5 so we can see what exactly they would have been deceived with. This is so important. Galatians 5, 1 through 10. The common issues that the Judeo-Christian converts would deal with would draw them from the glory that they had in Christ and return them to the law. Ephesians 5, 1 through possibly 10, we may stop short. For freedom, Christ has set us free. Just hear that. For freedom. Christ has set us free. Stand firm, therefore, and do not submit again to a yoke of slavery. This is Paul's admonishment to the Hebrew Christians. They were presented again with another law for them to hold to, and they were starting to waver. Look, I, Paul, say to you, that if you accept circumcision, Christ will be of no advantage to you.
I testify again to every man who accepts circumcision that he is obligated to keep the whole law. You are severed from Christ. You who would be justified by the law, you have fallen away from grace. For through the Spirit, by faith, we ourselves eagerly wait for the hope of righteousness. For in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision nor uncircumcision counts for anything, but only faith working through love. You are running well. Who hindered you from obeying the truth? This persuasion is not from him who calls you. A little leaven leavens the whole lump. What Paul is talking about is here were Hebrew people. This is one of his earliest letters in the letter of the Galatians. Here were the Hebrew people who had come to have faith in Jesus Christ. They had come to trust in Jesus Christ. And then a deceiver walks in and says, why aren't you keeping the law? You do realize that those Gentile Christians aren't being circumcised over there. They're supposed to be circumcised. They can't be a part of this people if they're not circumcised. You know they're not keeping the Sabbath too? Did you also see them eating a pig? They're breaking all sorts of laws. How, you guys, even though you say you're Christians, you still have to hold to all of these laws. You have to hold fast to them. And what was happening with the Galatians and what can be expected was happening with the people that the letter of Hebrews was written to is that they were losing sight of the price that Christ had paid. They were losing sight of the fact that Christ had purchased them. That he had paid the price of the law, that he had paid their debts of sin, and that he had fulfilled the law. And they were looking to pay their own way yet again. Yes, Jesus, we understand that you did all of this, but man, we still need to do a little bit of this. We do that today, don't we? Yes, Jesus, I know that you died for my sins, that you paid the penalty on the cross. But I have to sing very loud. I have to sing very loud. Otherwise, nobody will know that I'm a Christian. Nobody will really understand. Yes, Jesus, I know that you paid the price for my sins. But, you know, for the next 4 days, I'm going to fast because I'm so sinful. I'm so sinful. And I need to, in some way, pay you back for all that you've done. Yes, Jesus, I know that you did all this, but I can't accept that you would do it alone. I need to do something too. So I'm going to have this strict regimen of prayer and Bible reading. And you know, if I don't hold to it, I will be devastated because I failed you yet again. We create these laws and these rules that we have to hold to, not because we love Christ. We don't create the rules because we feel, you know, this is a great way for us to celebrate Jesus. We create the rules because we feel bad. Because we still have sin. We create the rules because we don't necessarily feel that what Jesus did was enough for us. We create the rules so that we can fill ourselves up and cover over some of the shame and guilt that we have. And not say that the blood of Christ has covered over all of the guilt and shame that we have. But there are the discerning. There are the discerning. Turn with me back to Hebrews 5:14. We're going to start in 12 just so we can see this again. For though by this time you ought to be teachers, they ought to have been teachers. You need someone to teach you again the basic principles of the oracles of God. You need milk, not solid food, for everyone who lives on milk is unskilled in the word of righteousness, since he is a child. But solid food is for the mature, for those who have their powers of discernment trained by constant practice to distinguish good from evil. Discerned, the discerning, those who have matured according to Christ's desire for them will see the error and know from their understanding of milk what it means to live a full Christian life. How wrong the wolves are, and then they will stand against those wolves. They will stand against the waves of error that are striking them, and they will continue in the path of good and correct actions. People who are taking in milk need assistance. They need assistance. And those who are eating food, who have the solid food before them, they are discerning. And they are to do what this passage actually expected the Hebrews to be doing. Teaching. They should have been teaching. And so those who have solid food, those who can discern, who will discern good from evil, they are to teach. They are to recognize error and seek to overcome it. And they are to help those who need maturing, who need milk, to become mature. Kaylee and Calvin, they couldn't stand against those waves. They couldn't overcome the waves that would be hitting them. They needed the shallows to learn. They needed to learn in the shallows of those wave pools how to get over a wave. But since Uncle Scotty is wise in the ways of the wave pool, apparently, say that three times fast, I was able to help them. And so it is with the mature. If you can discern the Word of God, if you can discern good from evil, it is your responsibility as an older brother and sister in Christ to be helping those who are taking in milk. What this text is not saying is, you know, we're not going to learn about Melchizedek or about the high priestly nature of Christ because you're not ready. It's saying is that there are some of you who will not be able to receive this because you are dull in hearing. Yet there are some of you who are wise in the ways of the Lord and who are discerning. And so for the discerning, assist. Assist. Take your younger brothers deeper and deeper into the depths. Help them to stand firm. Teach them maturity. Teach them to grow. Kaylee and Calvin wouldn't have known how to stay deep unless they had seen Uncle Scotty doing it. They wouldn't have seen how much work it required. They would have just thought, hey, we can go grab a hold of that rope and then we'll survive. No. They had to see it in action. And now the expectation is about 7 years down the line, once they actually do have their growth spurts, because the strubings are late bloomers, they will be able to do the same exact thing. Some of us are going to need milk. We're going to need it. It's nothing against it. It's just we haven't developed. And the expectation is, if you need milk, take it in. Feast on it. Take those basic principles and love and enjoy them. Because if we forego them, if we overlook them, it'll be our undoing. It'll be our end. But the practiced, the seasoned, the matured, these press on to the things of maturity. Press on. You are discerning, and in your discernment, you will be able to teach up others. This is our path, maturity. The expectation for the Christian is that we will be growing into the image of Christ. This is the role of the church concerning you. The church's purpose is to build and edify each believer into the image of Christ. And this is Christ's goal for us, to grow into him. Ignore it no longer. Ignore it no longer. Don't be dull of hearing. Don't be passive. I know how easy it is to be passive. Be purposeful. Be purposeful in your hearing. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we can feel the waves striking at our ankles. And we know that there is a rising tide in this country of unbelief and of disbelief and of contrary belief to your word, O Lord. And so, Lord, we ask for maturity. We ask that you would be growing us. And Lord, we just ask that if there would be in any of us dull ears or unbelief, that you would change our hearts and that you would convict us to hear and to listen closely and to grow in our understanding of your word, beginning with those elementary principles, and that in growing us, that we would be prepared to take in your meat and that we could enjoy it and digest it and grow in it so that we could teach others the wonders and the glories of your truth and your name. Father, we love you. We love the strength that you give us. We pray this all in your holy name.